I've been talking a lot about energy storage recently, mostly in the forms of various competing battery chemistries, but also in some other more imaginative technologies like molten salt, hot rocks, liquid air, and even your hot water tank at home. Energy storage is, and will continue to be, an absolutely crucial factor in the mass adoption of intermittent renewable power sources like wind and solar. After all, we've all heard the old cliche that the sun doesn't always shine and the wind doesn't always blow, haven't we? But that cliche only really holds true if your horizons are strictly limited to, well, the horizon. If you're prepared to step outside your own sphere of existence, then a whole kaleidoscope of possibilities suddenly comes into focus. And you don't need hallucinogenic drugs for the trip either. It can be achieved by the simple expedient of taking a look at an atlas. Because, of course, in reality, the sun is always shining and the wind is always blowing somewhere on planet Earth, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. So if there was a way of sending the power from the sun and the wind instantaneously from wherever it's happening at any given moment to wherever it's needed at that precise time, then we'd effectively have ourselves a network of global baseload renewable energy. Now, if that all sounds a bit Star Trek to you, then think again, because that's precisely the kind of infrastructure that's already being developed to move energy between east and west and from mid-latitude regions up to the northern hemisphere, where 90% of the human species lives and works. One of the most ambitious of those projects has just been unveiled by a UK company called Xlinx, and it looks set to blaze a trail for a revolution in the way we operate the electricity grids of the future. Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. Moving very large quantities of electricity over very long distances through high voltage direct current or HVDC cables is not a new concept. There's been a high voltage cable running from the Pacific Northwest down to Los Angeles for decades. There are several in Europe and Asia, and of course there's the monster 1.1 million volt Changi Guquan project carrying 12,000 megawatts of power over 3,000 kilometers from the wind and solar farms in the northwest of China to the urban conurbations on the country's east coast, supplying more than 26 million people with electricity. So the technology is well used and well proven. But few projects match the scale and scope of the infrastructure that Xlinx are currently putting together. It's called the Morocco-UK Power Project, and to borrow a strapline from an old TV commercial, it'll do exactly what it says on the tin. That means harnessing the reliable daily sunshine and wind that hits South Morocco 365 days a year and sending it into the UK electricity grid via massive subsea HVDC cables. Morocco is already aggressively pursuing its own transition to a grid supplied by renewables. In a recent web chat, the founder and CEO of Xlinx, Simon Morrish, explained to me that he and his team were acutely conscious of this vital ongoing work, so they liaised very closely with the Moroccan government to ensure they didn't use any land that may otherwise have been allocated for use by the local population for their own energy needs. Nevertheless, the site they've secured covers approximately 1,500 square kilometres, or about 580 square miles. That's an area the size of London, which for a wind and solar farm is enormous. But you could easily fit the lower 48 states of America within the borders of the Sahara Desert and still have plenty of room left over. So in that context, the footprint of the Morocco UK power plant is actually fairly negligible. What it'll provide though is space to install 7 gigawatts of solar PV panels plus 3.5 gigawatts of wind power and a 5 gigawatt 20 gigawatt hour battery energy storage facility. Those are some pretty huge numbers. When complete, the site will provide enough power for more than 7 million homes, representing 8% of the electricity demand, via two 1.8 gigawatt grid connections that have already been approved by the UK National Grid for installation on the North Devon coast. The solar PV power element of the Morocco site is fairly self-explanatory, I suppose. You get sunshine every day for more or less the same amount of time every day throughout the whole year, without the daily and seasonal intermittency that we have to put up with in more northern climes. What may not be quite so intuitive though is the potential of wind power in the same location. It turns out that the convection currents caused by the sun's movement across the desert sky during the day cause quite significant and predictable winds to pick up in the late afternoon. And those winds keep blowing all the way into the late evening and nighttime. That's perfect timing to keep the electrons flowing after the sun's gone down, but it also beautifully matches the high demand spikes of the UK grid as everyone comes home from work and puts the kettle on. In fact, the wind capacity factor at the site, which is how the industry assesses location feasibility, is 55%. That compares very favourably to the 40% capacity factor that the UK's offshore wind farms achieve. The on-site battery storage facility acts like a kind of massive control box to regulate the supply at the right frequency throughout the hours of darkness, reaching a state of full discharge just as the sun comes up each morning. All told, the facility will be producing at a capacity of 3.6 gigawatts for an average of 20 hours a day. Effectively, what you've got here is precisely the kind of baseload power from renewables that really would have seemed like science fiction just a few years ago. The combination of generation options also optimises the carrying capacity of the HVDC cables. The precise calculations for establishing cable load factors involve quite a lot of complicated variables that are outside the scope of this video. But in round figures, the solar PV panels just on their own provide a load factor on the cables of just over 40%. Adding wind power bumps that number up to around 70%, and then when you include the battery storage, the load factor gets close to 85%. But manufacturing those enormous cables has arguably turned out to be one of the biggest challenges of the entire project. The overall distance they'll need to cover is 3,800 kilometres. But to ensure security of supply, there'll be four cables in total, and that's a total of 15,200 kilometres. Global production capacity of this kind of monster cable is estimated to be something in the region of 4,000 kilometres a year. So Xlinx would require the entire world's supply every year for 4 years. And guess what? The entire world's supply is, unsurprisingly, already allocated to other projects. So if they were going to source the kit from existing manufacturers, Xlinx would be facing high prices and lead times of at least 5 years. A plant definition study commissioned from a company that specialises in building cable extrusion factories revealed that it would be more cost effective for Xlinx to set up their own production facility from scratch and build the HVDC cables themselves. So they began looking for appropriate sites in coastal locations around the UK. And they found just the spot up at Hunterston on the west coast of Scotland, where an existing nuclear power plant is due to close in 2023 with the loss of 500 jobs. Xlinx plan to build a new 6-line cable extrusion factory on a nearby site that'll become the largest cable manufacturing facility in the world, creating 900 well-paid, high-tech manufacturing jobs, hopefully absorbing many of the 500 redundancies from the power plant. All in, Xlinx projects to reach an overall cost of electricity of £48 per megawatt hour, which is the price they're aiming to secure in the UK government's Contracts for Difference, or CFD scheme. CFDs are long-term contracts between the government and electricity generators that allow the generator to stabilise their revenue at a pre-agreed level, known as the strike price, for the entire duration of the contract. When the market price for electricity falls below the strike price set out in the contract, the CFD scheme operator makes up the difference in payments to the generator. And when the market price is above the strike price, the generator pays that difference back to the scheme operator. UK Offshore Wind, for example, has a CFD cost of £40 per megawatt hour. Now, if you are a minister in the UK government's Department of Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy, you might be tempted to compare the £40 cost of offshore wind to the £48 projected cost of Xlinx wind and solar and come to the conclusion that you'd be better off sticking with the cheaper option. But that would be to overlook the critical difference between the two technologies. UK offshore wind remains a very intermittent source of power generation, and without wishing to blow your mind too much, that actually creates an unhelpful contortion of the CFD scheme. When there's loads of wind and the turbines are producing their peak output, electricity prices drop, which means the offshore wind generators are getting money from the CFD scheme to to guarantee their £40 contract price. But when there's no wind and consequently less electricity is being generated, then market prices tend to go up, often above the strike price of £40. But because the offshore wind generators are not actually producing very much electricity at those times, there's very little for them to pay back to the CFD scheme operator. Effectively, that's a subsidy that can only be enjoyed by an intermittent power source. By contrast, the Xlinx project will provide reliable baseload power, so they'll most likely be a significant net contributor to the coffers of the UK Exchequer, which makes them an unsubsidised power source at £48 per megawatt hour. Arguably then, a much more appropriate comparison would be with other baseload power generation facilities currently being built in the UK, like the Hinkley Point C nuclear reactor, for example. Hinkley has secured a CFD price of £92.50 per megawatt hour, nearly twice as much as the Moroccan facility. In that context, Xlinx starts to look like extremely good value indeed. Those negotiations are ongoing and are being led by Xlinx exec chair Sir Dave Lewis, who UK viewers may recognise as the ex-chief executive of our largest supermarket chain, Tesco. Meanwhile, back in Morocco, Xlinx is making progress in gaining the requisite regulatory and government approvals so that the country can benefit from the 10,000 jobs that will be created during the construction of the facility, 2,000 of which will become permanent positions. The total cost of the project, including the new cable extrusion factory, is £16 billion, with £40 million already secured for the development phase. Construction is due to commence in 2025, with the first system scheduled to go online in 2027. The Morocco-UK power project is probably pushing the boundaries of what's been achieved to date, and I'm sure there are those who quite understandably argue that we should be focusing far more on distributed energy solutions and be less reliant on large centralised facilities like this one. As an owner of rooftop solar panels myself, I'd certainly agree that those distributed energy generation sources will play an absolutely vital role in the transition to a more sustainable future. But here in the UK, we now have only 14 years left to achieve a mandated 100% net zero carbon electricity grid. There's a lot of nuclear and gas power due to come offline in the coming years, and despite the fine words of our current government, it's difficult to see a legitimate solution for baseload energy in the short term without projects like Xlinx. The new nuclear power plants currently under construction are taking far too long and are catastrophically over budget, and even the small modular reactors being developed by Rolls-Royce won't be online until 2035 at the very earliest. So right now, the case for baseload renewables via long-distance HVDC cables looks pretty compelling. No doubt there'll be plenty of you folks out there who have strong views on these kinds of projects one way or the other. So if you do, then why not jump down to the comment section below and share your thoughts there. That's it for this week though. As always, a big thank you to the folks at Patreon who keep these videos completely independent and ad-free. And a quick shout out to the folks who've joined since last time with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are Scott Ortkeys, Jamie Stillings, Geordie Fitzgerald, Justin Chipman, Don Piccoli, Casper Nielsen, Peter Holmquist, Chongololo, Michael Pritchard, Duncan McNeil, Joe Coletti, Clive Thompson, Will Erner, Bill Russell, Miguel Cardenas, Gerald Farmer, Mohamed Sayarial, Neil Gray, Andrew Graham, Neil Oakey, John Savitsky, Todd Sears, and Andre Canales. And of course, a huge thank you to everyone else who's joined since last time too. You can get involved with the team at Patreon and get the opportunity to exchange ideas and information with like-minded folks, plus watch exclusive monthly news updates from me and have your say on future programmes in monthly content polls by visiting www.patreon.com/justhaveathink. And you can hugely support the channel absolutely for free by subscribing and hitting that like button and notification bell. Dead easy to do all that. You just need to click down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week. And remember to just have a think. See you next week.